The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to Blessed Savior Lutheran Church in New Berlin. But actually, you folks should be welcoming me. I'm Pastor Stanton, and honored to help fill in here, leading worship and serving the congregation. And so thank you for the privilege. I love worship. That's going to be the theme this evening. And I love to serve. And so, again, I thank you for the opportunity. It was nice back in 2018 when I retired from St. Paul's in West Dallas to be able to sit next to my wife again in the pews and hear a sermon for a change. It was also nice because she always keeps something in her purse to keep me occupied during the sermon. So anyway, having said that, I've been serving a number of vacancies of late. The last one was Emmanuel up in Brookfield, and they went through a year and a half process of finding a pastor. And so it was kind of a lengthy vacancy for me, but I enjoyed it. You know already that you've placed a call to Pastor Tim Ritter down in Delavan to serve you. And we're going to remember him, his family, and our brothers and sisters at our Redeemer in Delavan, the congregation he now serves, in our prayers, that God would guide his decision. And again, today is Transfiguration. I'm going to call it the doorway between Lent and Epiphany, or Epiphany and Lent in my sermon, as today we prepare for Lent, which begins next Wednesday on Ash Wednesday. And we'll be talking about that in the sermon, in the children's lesson. Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins unto God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. The ninth chapter. Today's message is based in this text. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on a mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. As he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my Son, my chosen one. Listen to him." And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Well, I have here the faithful treasure chest, and I know you've used it in other Lenten years, whatever I said. And I have in the box, you actually have, some pieces of cloth with the word Alleluia on them. There are several in here. And Alleluia is a Hebrew word which means praise the Lord. It's a joyous word. It's a happy word. It's a word used for festivals. We sing Alleluia all over the place on Easter. And that's the point right now because we're about to enter Lent. And Lent is a more solemn time. I won't call it sad. That's the wrong word. But it's more solemn. It's a time when we think about our sins. We think about our Savior Jesus and how he suffered for us. And so it's a very quiet time. Kind of like, well, if you ever wanted to surprise somebody, say for their birthday, mine's in July, so don't get ready yet. But you want to surprise them for their birthday, and you know how you get in a room, and everybody, shh, be quiet now, be quiet. Before the person comes in the room, and when they open the door, of course, everybody jumps up and says, "Surprise! Happy birthday!" And that's a little bit like Lent. It's a quiet time in which it's kind of like, okay, now be quiet, hush now. The surprise is about to happen. And then Easter comes along, and all of a sudden the lights go up on Easter morning, and we sing Alleluias all over the place. And it's a joyous, joyous morning for us, and we always look forward to that. It's one of my favorite days of the church year. And so for a period of time now, Lent, for the next several weeks, 40 days, we're going to put aside our Alleluia. We're going to put our Alleluias in this treasure box and set it aside under the altar, and we'll take them back out on Easter morning. And this begins next Ash Wednesday. So today will be our last opportunity to sing Alleluia for a while. Pray with me. Dear Lord God, be with us this season as we enter Lent. Help us in our quietness, in our reflection, in our thinking about our sin and our need for a Savior. Help us, Lord, to prepare our hearts to receive Him. Help us, even when we're not singing Alleluia, to praise You in our hearts and prepare us for the joyous celebration of Easter. In Jesus' name, amen. We join in the hymn. Thank you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. It's good, Lord, to be here. Luke 9, verses 28 to 36. This Lord's Day, together in worship, it is good, Lord, to be here. This mountaintop experience, as we hear God's word and receive at his table the true body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, given and shed for the forgiveness of all of our sins. It's good, Lord, to be here, where the font reminds us of our baptism, in which we have died and risen in Christ as new creations, rising forth every day in newness of life. It's good, Lord, to be here as we join Peter, James, and John on a mountaintop, standing before the transfigured Jesus and bid to see only and to hear only him. Today we're going to look at the transfiguration of our Lord from a little bit different perspective, the perspective of worship. What is worship all about? How is what we do on Sunday morning connected to what we do all week long? I recall my first encounter with worship as a child. In my early life, Sunday mornings were getting up early, putting on, you know, your best clothes, driving out to our small town church, singing hymns, hearing a sermon, and enjoying hot chocolate in the basement fellowship hall. Now, at some point, my family became Lutheran. We didn't start out that way. I grew up on a farm in Michigan. The town grew, and with it, our church grew, and it grew to such a point that my parents didn't quite feel comfortable there anymore. We were not Lutheran at that point. However, we had some friends on a neighboring farm just down the road who reached out and encouraged us to join their church. And so we got up early on Sunday, put on our best clothes, and drove to church. The usher met us at the door. He was wearing striped pants, a plaid jacket, checkered tie, white socks, and farmer shoes, and we knew we were home. We went inside, sat down, stood up, sat down, stood up again. We sang hymns to an old pipe organ. The old wood floors were creaky, and there was a statue of Jesus on the altar, and he looked pretty friendly. The pastor climbed up several steps into a high pulpit, and we heard a sermon, said some prayers, and had hot chocolate in the fellowship hall. And I do recall that Lutheran hot chocolate tasted for all the world like the hot chocolate in the other church. As I grew, I came to love our Lutheran worship service, everything from the Bible. And we discovered that worship is not just for Sunday mornings. For first, we discovered that worship is an uphill climb. And as we followed Jesus with Peter, James, and John up to the summit of the Mount of Transfiguration, we quickly find out that climbing uphill is tiresome, exhausting, it's difficult. We're all out of breath. In the verses before our text, Jesus speaks of his impending suffering, death, and resurrection. Remember what Peter did and said at that point in Matthew 16? He pulls Jesus roughly aside by the shoulder, and he declares, "No, Lord, this will never happen to you." We know what Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan." Jesus was headed to the cross. He was single-minded. He had a mission. He was going to Jerusalem there to suffer and die for us. Transfiguration, as I said in the opening, is really like a doorway to me between Epiphany and Lent. Epiphany, the season of God in flesh made manifest, the glory of God revealed appearing in the incarnate Son of God, Jesus Christ. And in Lent, that glory must be buried, almost buried, covered in the suffering and death of God's Son, that a whole world might be forgiven. But now, on this mount, Jesus appears with Moses and Elijah. You know, Moses, the lawgiver, and Elijah, who with the other prophets spoke of the coming Messiah who would save all people. It's here on this mountaintop that the Son of God is revealed in all his shining glory. His appearance was changed. In the Greek, the word is metamorphe, from which we get the English word metamorphosis. It's what happens to a butterfly when the butterfly spins a cocoon, spends some time in there. As a caterpillar, he spins a cocoon, spends some time in there, and then he breaks out as a butterfly. Metamorphe, changed. Of this event, Peter writes in his second epistle, "We were eyewitnesses of his majesty." It's good, Lord, to be here. For just a moment, to catch a glimpse of our Lord's glory, to be prepared and strengthened and encouraged for the days ahead. Yes, worship can be an uphill climb. Our hearts, our lives, our minds can be filled with worries, busyness, fears, desires and heartaches, joys and pains. And all of those cobwebs need to be cleared away so that we can see and only hear Jesus. Worship is all about an encounter with the living God. Does it strike you that so many important events in the Bible occur on mountains? Abraham and Isaac on Mount Moriah, as Abraham nearly sacrifices his only son in a picture of God's sacrifice of his only son on Calvary. Then there's Moses and the burning bush on Sinai, and here standing on either side of Jesus are those two, Moses and Elijah. And so in this mountaintop experience, Peter gets all excited. Who wouldn't be? In fact, he wants to build three shelters there on the summit. One for Jesus, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Instead of just basking and experiencing our Lord's glory, Peter wants to engage in a building program. The big fisherman wants to stay up there on the mountaintop. He doesn't want to go back down below. But a voice from a cloud interrupts. "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." Then Moses and Elijah disappear, and we read, "They saw no one but Jesus." Oh, it's all too easy for you and I to get all caught up in life's busyness, the to-do lists of ministry and everyday life. Worship is all about focusing our attention on Jesus and listening to him only. As we hear the inspired words of Hebrews 12, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame." It's good, Lord, to be here, for it is here in the midst of our sin, our hurts and pains, our busyness and distractions, that you reach out and you touch us. After God speaks from the cloud, we read in Matthew's gospel that the disciples fell down with their faces to the ground. They were terrified. Our Lord reaches out. He touches them. He says, "Rise and have no fear." Our Lord touches each one of us in his word, in the miracle bath of baptism, in the forgiveness feast of his supper. It is here that we're prepared for our lives of worship down on the valley and in the plains. Because all too soon it was time for Jesus and Peter and James and John to descend from the mountain to the valleys and plains below. There were waiting people, possessed with evil spirits, those who were paralyzed and sick, the afraid, the suffering, the blind, those who were dying, those with doubts and all kinds of issues, those who were too busy or not nearly busy enough. In other words, people like you and me. And waiting there for Jesus to climb was yet one more mountain, Mount Calvary. There on the cross, the transfigured Savior would be disfigured for a people who were disfigured by sin, that you and I might be transfigured, changed, transformed into the children of God, and equipped for worship and ministry in this death valley of a world. It's good, Lord, to be here, to worship and serve in our everyday lives. For worship is what we do every day as believers in Jesus Christ. Luther saw worship in everyday things. He held that a common milkmaid did more in terms of worship and service to God than all the bishops, the monks, and priests combined. He said, "What you do in your house is worth as much as if you did it in heaven for our Lord God." And Luther also said, "The worship of God should be free at table, in private rooms, downstairs, upstairs, at home, abroad, in all places, at all times." As Jesus sent his disciples down to the valleys below, he went with them. We are not in this alone. And so as you pray in your bed at night, as you read your Bible, as you comfort a friend or a neighbor, as you clean up a spill, as you help someone with their food tray or push a wheelchair or witness to someone who visits, as you change a diaper, remember that it's time to worship every day. It's time to descend to the valley and the plains waiting below. It's time to follow our Savior to that other mountain with its cross. Thank you for inviting me to share worship with you. It's good to be home. It's good, Lord, to be here with all of you. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. At this time, we rise and join in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to rise for prayer. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, in prayer your Son Jesus revealed his glory to Peter, James, and John. Grant that we, also gathered in prayer, would see him in, by faith and receive from him the redemption he has accomplished for us. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. O God, your Son shines in resurrected light. Illuminate your church with his own brightness, that she would tell the world of his mighty deliverance. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Lord of the churches, we pray this day for Pastor Tim Ritter, whom we have called to serve as his pastor. According to your will, we ask that you would guide him to a decision in the call that he serves now and the calls that he has received. We further pray for his family and our brothers and sisters at our Redeemer Lutheran Church in Delavan. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Heavenly Father, as your Son cares faithfully for his holy church, grant us a sure confidence in him and give us faithful hearts to serve him according to the callings he has given us. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Almighty Father, you alone establish all authority on earth. Bless those entrusted with this responsibility, both here and abroad, that they would serve with integrity and honor and for the well-being of all. And this day, Lord, we think of those who serve us in the military and first responders and their families. that you would bless these folk who serve us, watch over them, keep them safe, and be with them as they do their duty. We pray for your peace in the midst of growing tensions in Ukraine, asking that all division, conflict, and strife would give way to peace and quietness. Lord, in your mercy, Father of all comfort, as we follow the way of your apostles into your presence, we join our prayers in ceaseless petitions to your dear Son. Hear us for the sake of the troubled, the sick, and the dying, and especially Judy, Karen, Nancy, Cindy, Millie, and Joyce. We also pray that you would comfort those who grieve, sustaining them with a certain hope of the resurrection unto eternal life. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, you gave your Son as the final sacrifice for sin. As he faithfully prepares his own body and blood for us Christians to eat and drink, grant us confidence to draw near to him and receive him worthily. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember on this day the glorious manifestation of your Son's divinity on the Mount of Transfiguration. Teach us to listen to Jesus and ever fix our eyes on him and his innocent suffering and death for our forgiveness. By your grace and mercy, strengthen us to remain faithful in all circumstances of trial, temptation, and persecution. Preserve us to the end, that we may die a blessed death, believing in your beloved Son, with whom you are well pleased. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.